The American chestnut was a really important tree species historically. It existed in eastern North America for about 10 million years. It had a range from southern Canada, south into Mississippi, east from the Piedmont, west to the Ohio River Valley. So it had about a 200 million acre range, and it was thought to occupy about 3 to 4 billion trees. It was extremely versatile, extremely widespread. It was thought to be a keystone species, and it was here for 10 million years, and it was virtually wiped out in less than 60 from the blight that came in.
Breeding for resistance to the chestnut blight started almost immediately after the blight was discovered. Scientists realized that they could cross Asian chestnut species like Chinese and Japanese chestnut with the American chestnut to get blight resistance. But the trick was to get a tree that not only had blight resistance, but also had good timber form and grew fast like the American chestnut. In the mid-1980s, an approach was developed called back cross breeding. With back cross breeding, a hybrid tree is produced that theoretically has 94% of its genome from the American chestnut and 6% from an Asian chestnut species like the Chinese chestnut. We refer to these trees as BC3F3s, or the third back cross generation. This breeding work has taken many decades to carry out, and it is still ongoing.
From a regional standpoint, though we manage vast landscapes of southern pine and upland hardwoods, we never want to lose sight of the conservation of forest tree species that are threatened, or in the case of the American chestnut, were lost. We want to support and be an active part of the chestnut reintroduction as we continue working with our partners, such as the Southern Research Station of the U.S. Forest Service, University of Tennessee, and the American Chestnut Foundation, and provide test sites for chestnut plantings on the Southern Region National Forest.
We established our very first research test planting of American chestnut in 2009, and actually where I'm standing is the very first research test planting of American chestnuts that have ever been established on the National Forest System using the most advanced breeding material available at the time. These test plantings represent a culmination of over 100 years of research and breeding efforts that have been underway to get a blight-resistant American chestnut established back into its native range.
We knew that we had to grow the best seedlings possible for planting so that the trees would be competitive in the woods and would escape deer browsing more quickly. So we grew the trees from nuts in a commercial nursery for 1 year to maximize their growth and size prior to planting. For every tree we were going to plant, we counted the seedling's roots and measured its height and its stem diameter. We sorted the trees into an experimental design for planting so we can empirically test the effects of breeding, genetics, and seedling size on overall field performance over time.
We established 13 plantings starting in 2009, and we also established plantings in 2010, 2011, in 2015. In all, we've planted about 4,500 trees in three states on three national forests, the Cherokee, the Nantahala, and the George Washington Jefferson. We established this planting in 2009 with nuts that were collected in 2007 from the American Chestnut Foundation's orchard in Meadowview, Virginia. In this particular planting where I'm standing, we planted around 400 trees total, and about half of those are the BC3F3 trees, or the third generation back cross trees, which are the most advanced breeding generation available for us to test. And those trees are predicted to be highly blight resistant, but also look and behave like an American chestnut. So we want to see if the trees we planted out here are going to have those desirable characteristics of the American chestnut, but have the desirable blight resistance of the Asian species like the Chinese chestnut. So one of the important things that we're looking at in these plantings is not just whether or not the tree is going to be resistant, but whether the tree is going to be able to compete with all of these native species around it. We have poplars, and here's a small poplar, and there's birches and striped maples and trees like that, that this tree has to be able to get its head above and get the sunlight in order to stay competitive and then eventually, hopefully, produce fruit and reproduce. As of the 12th growing season after planting, about 60% of the trees that we planted are alive. So 40% of them have died. The majority of them died early on, right after planting. And that's kind of common for hardwood plantings. Trees go through what you call planting shock, where they have been growing in a nursery and you take them out of that nice environment and put them out into the real world and they kind of go into a shock period. So it can sometimes actually kill them. But also trees die for other unknown reasons that we don't totally understand. They could have gotten browsed too much by deer. They could have gotten defoliated by insects. They could have gotten cicada damage. So there's lots of reasons that trees die other than just getting the chestnut blight. And that's really important for us to document over time to give managers that baseline information for how these trees are going to survive and perform over the long term. This tree where I'm standing has really good form. It's tall, it's straight. It's going straight up into the canopy. Most of its leaves are up in the canopy and they're getting direct sunlight, which is going to be really good for nut production and flower production long term. Whereas a Chinese chestnut is going to grow a little bit more shrubby in appearance and be shorter and have more forking. And it's just not going to be as competitive as a pure American chestnut. And what we found is that the B3 F3 trees look identical to the American chestnut. And they're growing pretty similarly to the pure American chestnut, although slightly less fast than the American chestnut. But that could change over time. The tallest trees on this site reached 40 feet in 10 years, and that's pretty remarkable. They're averaging around 25 feet in height growth right now on average across the entire stand after 12 years. The BC3 F3 trees are doing significantly better in terms of blight resistance compared to the pure American chestnuts that we planted. About half of the BC3 F3 trees are still blight free compared to only about 20% of the American chestnuts.
Two of the biggest problems we face with restoration of American chestnut other than blight resistance is deer browse on newly planted seedlings and Phytophthora root rot. We can mitigate for the deer browse by planting larger size seedlings and using tree shelters. We mitigate for root rot by being very careful about site selection to plant on well-drained sites. We've documented other non-native pests that have had some negative impacts to our plantings. The Asiatic oak weevil defoliates trees but doesn't seem to kill them. The Asian gall wasp lays eggs inside of newly developing buds and inhibits growth and flowering. The ambrosia beetle attacks weakened or dying trees. Restoration really has to be about more than planting a blight-resistant tree. We have to also consider the impacts of other non-native pests that are here now and those that are likely to come.
Working with Dr. Clark is an important part of a National Forest System restoration goals and objectives because she's focusing on the restoration of the American chestnut. The silvicultural toolbox is relatively unknown for restoring American chestnut. As Dr. Clark's research develops further, we begin to understand more information about how American chestnut competes within the local communities that it's growing in. And based on that information, we can design treatments that are beneficial to creating conditions for American chestnut to survive and thrive as we look at restoration opportunities.
These research test plantings represent over 100 years of research and breeding efforts. We're only in the second decade of research in these test plantings, and American chestnuts can live over 300 years old. So we're really in the early phases of understanding how this tree is going to perform out in the real world forest conditions like you see here today. So we think if you can get a tree that is going to maintain blight resistance over time, you will be able to restore these trees back into their native range.